Guys, thank you so much for joining this Saturday. For some of you, it's early in the morning. And for some of you, it's late Saturday evening. And you have taken the time to join this webinar to learn something interesting, to grow your career, to gain more knowledge, so on. Right. So thank you so much for joining. We really appreciate you being here. And we'll make sure this 1 hour is going to be interesting, educational, and you're going to learn something from this. All right. Sounds good. So just a brief introduction about myself. My name is Patrick. I'm one of the lead course creators at HadoopandRealWorld.com. If you're not sure about who we are, I'm not going to give a big lecture. We've been involved with Hadoop and big data technologies for quite some time now. We have a website called HadoopandRealWorld.com where we publish courses, write blog posts, do webinars like this, all the fun and interesting stuff. So we have a few courses out which you can enroll now, and a couple of those courses are free in Hadoop and Spark. So the free courses are Hadoop Starter Kit and Spark Starter Kit. We always say our free courses are better than others' paid courses, and when you take these courses, you will understand why. Okay. So when you get a chance, please check it out. It's courses.hadoopandrealworld.com. You will you can learn about Hadoop and Spark, and if you're more interested in the topic, you can enroll in one of our paid courses as well. Okay, so that's enough about me and about Hadoop and Real World. Let's hear from you guys, okay? Just give us three pieces of information: your name, where are you from, and are you new to Hadoop and Real World? Are you enrolled in any of our courses? Just let us know where you stand right now. Okay, you can type it in the chat and let everyone know where you are from. Okay, so Prasad is working as a Hadoop admin and he's from USA. Great, Prasad. Thank you. And who else? Okay, Shilpa from NYC, just starting to learn Hadoop with the Starter Kit. Great, Shilpa. Thank you. Welcome. Paul, Arkansas, nice. Hadoop admin, USA. Sudhakar, working as a Hadoop admin, Bangalore, India, nice. Okay. Richmond, Hrishikesh, working as a data engineer. Raga, working as a big data engineer. USA, about to take the Spark course with HRW. Great. Bangalore, senior Java developer. Okay, so a lot of people from India and US. From France, Kyusu from France. Okay. We have consulted with one of the French investment banks, some time ago. So I'm very familiar France. Okay, cool. Hemant from Chicago, Prem PM, Hadoop Project, GGN, Kuldeep from Bangalore, Dhiraj from Bangalore. Excellent. Thank you guys. Thank you. Thank you so much. From Ernst & Young. Nice. Nice. Satish working as a data engineer in Hyderabad. Okay, so a lot of people from India, US, and I saw someone from France. So that's great. Thank you. So let's talk about today's agenda, okay? So today we are going to talk about Kafka Schema Registry, and more specifically, we are going to talk about schema management and schema evolution with Kafka Schema Registry, okay? So, we are going to talk some topics. If you're very new to the big data space, it might sound foreign to you, okay? But don't get excited, don't get scared that you don't know these topics. If you're just new to the Hadoop and the big data world, just listen to what we are saying. It will all make sense, okay? Even if you don't understand every single thing that we are trying to say, that is totally fine. That is totally normal. Okay. Everyone is not at the expert level. That is totally fine. I'm going to give you a brief introduction of each and everything. So even if you are not familiar with those tools or topics, you would be able to follow this webinar. Sounds good? Okay. So before we talk about Kafka Schema Registry, how many in this webinar know already about what is Kafka? You can show us in the chat, please. Are you familiar with Kafka already? Yes, Kuldeep says yes, great. Yes, a lot of people. Okay, so anyone not familiar with Kafka? So that's great, you know. So, okay, so Kishu is saying a few intro. He has few intro. Shilpa says, no, that's good. No problem. Okay. So a lot of people are new to Kafka, okay? So first, let's start there. You know, before we talk about Kafka Schema Registry, first, let's talk about what is Kafka. Kafka is a distributed message broker. Right? What does a distributed message broker mean? Why don't we see that with an example? Okay. And this is a use case that we showed in our Hadoop developer and real world course. Right? So we made this as a nice project, a production ready project in Hadoop developer and real world course. And that's what you're going to see today. Okay. So meetup.com. So I'm sure most of you are familiar with meetup.com. So meetup.com provide a streaming API where you can see live RSVPs. As the members of meetup.com RSVP to a meetup, you will see that here, okay? So you can see here that as RSVPs are coming in, you know, meetup.com is sending that information over to us, okay? You see how this is happening, right? This is very interesting piece of information that meetup.com is providing us for free, right? We don't have to pay anything. It's basically a streaming API. Okay, so it is great if I want to consume the RSVPs from meetup.com, it is great. I can go here and consume the information. But there is a problem here, right? Meaning, I don't have a point of reference to the past, okay? I don't know what RSVPs came through before I hit enter on this browser, right? Because I lost all the messages. I don't have any point of reference to the messages. When I'm consuming, I'm live and I can consume the RSVPs as they are coming in. But if I want to go back and consume some of the messages, I won't be able to, right? A message broker like Kafka helps you with that, right? So what meetup.com can do is, instead of providing this streaming API, they can push RSVP into Kafka, and Kafka will keep that message safe and sound, okay? So as a consumer, if I'm interested in consuming the RSVPs from meetup.com, all I have to do is go to the Kafka cluster and download the message. You know, I'm just saying download, but you can get the message from the Kafka cluster, right? A Kafka cluster is made up of several nodes. It's fully distributed, right? So a producer will push the message to the Kafka cluster, and a consumer can consume the message from the Kafka cluster at their own pace, okay? Meetup.com is a big company, right? And they have a lot of servers, so they can push a lot of messages per second, right? They can produce thousands of messages per second, thousands of RSVPs per second. But if I'm a consumer running in my laptop, right, I can only consume so much. No problem. Right? The messages are safe and sound in Kafka. In this case, the RSVPs are safe and sound in Kafka. So you can consume at your own pace. Okay? That's an oversimplification of what Kafka is. Right? So now you have an understanding, right? A producer is pushing something to Kafka. Right? A producer is pushing something to Kafka. And then the consumer, it's consuming the messages from Kafka. Make sense? All right. Cool. Now, let's build on this use case, right? Again, as I said, this use case is, we turned this use case into a project in Hadoop developer and real world course, okay? So, we're going to consume this API. We're going to write a Kafka producer using Spring Boot and Spring Kafka integration on all the latest things, right? We're going to write the producer. We're going to call the streaming API and convert the RSVP into a message, push it to a Kafka cluster, right? And we're also going to write a Kafka consumer, and we are going to consume the message from the Kafka cluster. Make sense? That's what we're going to do. Okay, so now let's build on this use case, right? Meetup.com, that's what they're going to do. They're not going to stream the RSVPs through an API. They're going to push it to a Kafka cluster, okay? So to consume from the Kafka cluster, what do we need to do? What do we need to know to consume a message from the Kafka cluster, right? We need to know the structure of the message, don't you agree, right? If you don't know, if you don't have a clue of what and how the message is being constructed by meetup.com, you cannot take that message and do anything with it, right? So how can we do that, right? How can we have that information? That's where schema comes in, okay? A schema will look like something like this, okay? A schema is made up of fields. Think of schema as a language, guys, right? Let's say you want to talk to me, right? You and I have to communicate for something. For the very first thing is we both need to agree on a language, right? If I can speak in German and you can speak in French, right? And if both of us know only one language, that's not going to help, right? We're not going to do effective communication. So for the communication to work, both producer and consumer need to have a proper understanding of the schema. A schema is nothing but a structure of the message, okay? The structure of the message that the producer will push to Kafka and how the consumer can consume that message. So schema is going to act as a bridge or a contract between producer and consumer, okay? So you can see, take a look at this schema. This is specifically an Avro schema. I'll come what is Avro in a bit, okay? But take a look at this schema. Here we are saying each message is going to have these fields, okay? Every RSVP message, it's going to have a bunch of fields. It's going to have RSVP ID, group name, that is the meetup name, right? Event ID, what is the actual event? Event name, member ID, member name, who's RSVPing to the event, venue ID, and venue name, okay? You also have data types for each of the fields. RSVP ID is long, group name is string, so on and so forth, right? So when you know the schema, as a consumer, you know exactly what meetup.com is pushing to the Kafka cluster, right? With this information, you can take the message and you can reconstruct the message on your site, okay? So this, I said, it's specifically an Avro schema. So now let's talk about what is Avro, okay? These are just building blocks. Again, if you're not familiar with these tools, don't get scared, right? Don't get too anxious. It's okay, it's totally normal, right? I'm just getting you introduced to few new tools, that's it, right? So what is Avro? So if you wanna send a piece of information over the network, right? Over the wire, over the network, you need to serialize that information. You need to turn that information into bits and bytes, right? So Avro is a serialization framework, very simple. It takes your message, you can serialize it with Avro using the schema, right? And then you can send it across on the wire. So Kafka can keep it nice and sound, right? Similarly, on the other side, consumer can take the message and deserialize it using Avro, right? So you producer serialize it with Avro, consumer deserialize it with Avro, producer use the schema to serialize, consumer use the same schema to deserialize, right? So that's where Avro is a powerful tool. Another great thing about Avro, okay? So a developer in meetup.com is going to push the RSVP into the Kafka cluster, right? He can be a Python programmer, right? And what about the consumer? Consumer, you can write your programs in Java, totally okay, right? With Avro, you can serialize using Python, but you can read the same object or you can deserialize the same message or object using Java or Scala, whatever, right? You can use any programming language on either side to do the serialization and deserialization, right? Okay, so now, what have we learned so far? You know, let's summarize, okay? So we have meetup.com, and meetup.com has decided they're going to push live RSVP messages into a Kafka cluster, and Kafka is a distributed message broker, which basically allows producer to push messages and consumer to consume messages at their own pace. It's going to keep the message safe and sound, thereby giving us the reliability, okay? Good so far. Now, We also talked about schema. Schema is like a language, right? It's a contract between producer and consumer. Schema tells you the structure of the message, right? How the message is structured. So when producer will use the schema and a serialization framework like Avro to serialize the message, and consumer can then use the same Avro serializer or deserializer to deserialize the message using the schema. Okay, so these are the things that we have seen so far. All right, so now we have created Kafka producer and Kafka consumers already, okay, with this information. So this program right here, so if you look at the producer, I'm just going to quickly go through. We don't have time to walk through the code in detail, but I'm just going to show you what this code is actually doing. So this code basically connects to meetup.com and it's building an RSVP message using the schema, okay? And then once the RSVP message is built, it is serialized and it will be sent to Kafka, okay? And the send message does send to the Kafka cluster. All the property values are here, right? The schema registry, which I'll come in a bit. The topic name, this is the place in Kafka where we are pushing the messages. This is the topic inside Kafka where we are pushing the messages. This is the actual RSVP URL from meetup.com, okay? So we have basically simulated, you know, what meetup.com could do if they decide to push the message into a Kafka cluster, okay? So now, the interesting part, I'm going to start this project, okay? When I start this project, we will see the messages are being fed through and getting pushed to Kafka. All right, so this project is already compiled. I've done all that. So I'm going to hit Start Producer Application. So this is going to take a few seconds. So let's give IntelliJ the time. Don't worry if you have questions. You know, I don't want to break the flow, but you know, I'll pause in the middle to come back if you have any questions, okay? So the application is starting. All right, there you go, you see it. So let me maximize it so that you have a full view of it, right? So now our producer program is consuming the messages from meetup.com streaming API, turning that into an RSVP message, and sending it to the Kafka cluster with Avro serialization using the schema which we just saw. Okay, sounds great so far. So you can look all the information right here. You know, so these messages are being pushed into the Kafka cluster right now. Okay, sounds great, right? So meetup.com has done their job. They are now pushing messages to the Kafka cluster. Now, we are the consumers. We are interested in fetching the messages from the Kafka cluster and looking at these RSVPs, right? So how can we get this information? What is the piece of information that you need to know to get the message and to read the message? Can you answer me? If you are a consumer, what is the first thing you need to know to consume the messages based on what you heard so far? Let's see. A topic is required. Schema details. Exactly, precisely. You need to know the topic. Absolutely, yes. Topic and schema, right? You need to know the topic. Great. You guys are following great, okay? So topic, yes, you need to know the topic because topic is where the messages are being held in the Kafka cluster, right? So absolutely, yes, you need to know the topic. But more importantly, you need to know, of course, the server details and all that, right? Server details, where the Kafka cluster is hosted, you need to know the topic and all that. But from the message standpoint, you need to know the schema. Schema is very important, right? Because if you don't know the schema, if you don't know the contract, you cannot know the structure of the message. You cannot recreate the message on your site. You cannot deserialize the message on your site. Makes sense, right? So how do we get the schema? How do we get the schema? Who's going to provide us the schema? Of course, you know, you can ask meetup.com, but Imagine this, this is a free service, right? Meetup.com is not going to have like customer reps sitting on the phone and telling you the schema. No, they're not going to, you know, they're not going to do any more than what they have done already. That's where schema registry comes in play, okay? Schema registry helps us create, helps us with schema management. It gives us the transparency between the producer and consumer, right? I don't need anyone's help actually, right? If I know the schema registry, I can get to know the schema, okay? So Kafka Schema Registry is another service that runs along with the Kafka cluster, right? Kafka admins would configure it and then they would bring it up, okay? So whenever a message is being pushed to Kafka, you can configure it in such a way that the message, that the schema will automatically get registered for the topic, okay? The schema will automatically get registered for the topic. And the interesting thing is Schema Registry provides you REST APIs and you can call the REST endpoints to get the information you want, okay? So this tool right here, it's a free tool called Postman, which lets you issue REST commands or REST or hit REST endpoints to get some information. You pass some information to a URL and you get some information back. Very, very simple, right? So here, you know, this is our Kafka cluster, the Kafka cluster that we built at Hadoop and Real World. And our schema registry is running right here on this host called PlayOne on the port 8081, okay? And this is our topic. This is the name of our topic that I created just like 10 minutes before this webinar. hrwmeetup.com/webinar, okay? And you prefix it with dash value, and then you say /versions/latest to get the latest version of the schema, okay? So let's go on and hit send. There you go. I have the schema right here, and this is the version one. This is the very first version of the schema, okay? So if you take this, remove all the quotes and the escape characters, you will see a schema like this, exactly like this, right? Exactly this, not like this, exactly this, right? And I can go to my consumer project, which is right here. And again, I would have specified the schema here as well. I can just copy paste the schema, right? I can just copy paste the schema and that is it. Now I have the schema, right? I don't have to call anyone. All I have to do is just issue a REST request to the Kafka schema registry on the topic to get the latest schema. And that's all I need, okay? So now I have the schema. I know how to interpret the message. Very, very simple, right? Again, so we have written a consumer program as well. Now this consumer program will listen to the Kafka cluster and then download and deserialize the message, right? Not a lot of code, small, you know, like a few lines of code here and there, and then we are done, okay? So the information about the topic name and things like that are here. Most importantly, the information about the schema registry is also here, okay? So imagine, so just recognize, right? I said our schema is running on PlayOne, a port 8081, okay? Makes sense, right? Okay, so now we are producing messages. Our producer has been producing messages, right? Nonstop. So now we are ready to consume our messages. So I have the schema as well, as I said. And where did I get the schema from? I got the schema from the schema registry because schema registry helps me with schema management. Okay, so now let's select producer, sorry, consumer, and then let's start consumer. Looks like my consumer is already running, so I'm going to stop it. Now I'm going to run it. There you go. We are now successfully connected to a Kafka cluster and we are consuming the messages. Sounds good? All right. So, any questions so far? Let's take a few questions before I move on to the next thing. The schema can be automatically updated. We can configure in such a way that whenever you push messages to a Kafka cluster, that the schema will be automatically updated on the schema registry. And I'll show you exactly where in the piece of code that we do that, okay? Give me 1 second. So you go here, you go here, you go here, config. And so if I scroll down, you see here, auto register schema set to true. So in this program, I have set in such a way that whenever I push messages into a Kafka cluster, I want to auto register the schema. So you can choose not to, right? That's up to you. But you know, in some production environments, we have seen this auto register is set to false, you know, and you can update the schema in a different way. And I'll also show you that in the webinar. So there are different ways to do it, right? If you want to play really safe, you can set this to false. And I'll explain why that's the case, okay? Let's see, what else? Okay, the recording will be available for this course. Yes, yes, we will provide you the recording. Actually, it will be uploaded to our YouTube channel. So yes, and we'll send out a link as well. Without the schema registry, a consumer can get messages. Yes, of course. You can get the messages without a schema registry. If someone gave you the schema, you can use that schema and you can start downloading. That's fine too. How to get the earlier version of a schema? All you have to say is, you know, you put a version number here, version /1 or version/2, you will get the earlier version of the schema as well. Okay, all right, cool. So let's move on. Okay, so where do we stand right now? We have the producer, we have the consumer, both are happy. We're all happy, right? Because we have the meetup.com is pushing messages to Kafka. We are able to consume it, you know, from Kafka. Both producer is happy, consumers are happy. Great. But let's talk about the schema a little bit, okay? So when we went live, right, meetup.com went live with this schema, right? So if you think about it, it's naive to think that this schema is set in stone, right? That this schema is not going to change forever, right? It's not realistic to think that, right? So meetup.com might have few more fields and they may want to add few more fields to the schema, right? They might think that some fields are obsolete, not adding any value, and they might think like, I'm going to remove this, right? It's not needed, I'm going to remove it. Right? So schemas will evolve over time, guys, right? Change is constant, isn't it, right? So schema is going to evolve over time. You will be adding fields to schema. You could be adding or removing fields from schema. That's called schema evolution, right? But the important thing about schema evolution is when you make a change to the schema, you need to know which change would affect my consumer and which change will not affect my consumer. Based on that, you know, based on your understanding of that, you can take appropriate steps to prevent from accidental changes breaking producers or consumers. Make sense what I'm saying, right? So there has to be someone who should be helping us with schema evolution. And Kafka Schema Registry, with the help of compatibility types, helps us with schema evolution. So Kafka Schema Registry does two things, okay? It provides us certain compatibility types which define rules of what is allowed and what is not allowed based on that compatibility type, right? What changes are allowed and what changes are not allowed based on the compatibility type, right? And also this will give you a guideline of what needs to happen for a change, right? When you make a change with this understanding, you'll be absolutely certain whether a consumer will be affected. If it is affected, what you need to do, right? You would be better prepared in making changes to the schema or when you make changes to the schema, right? So Kafka Schema Registry also helped with schema evolution. And that's what we are going to see now, okay? All right. Okay, so I'm looking at the producer side schema, okay? In the producer side schema, if you look at it closely, right? If you look at it closely, you have, for each field, you have defined the name, type, and sometimes you have also defined a default value. So for example, for venue ID and venue name, you have defined default values. When you don't provide a value, when a consumer don't provide a value, the default value can be applied. That's what it means, okay? It also means it's an optional column, right? In the absence of a value, the optional or the default value will be applied. That's what it means, right? So if you don't, if the producer failed to provide a venue name, maybe that event doesn't have a venue, okay? So in that instance, the default value will be applied, okay? For fields where you don't have a default column, these fields are called required column or mandatory column. You need to have a value for these columns, right? Consumers are expecting it, okay? Consumer expect a value for these columns, right? These are not optional columns. These are required columns. So now question, okay? I'm gonna ask a question. I'm going to remove this column from the producer, okay? I'm going to remove this column from the producer. What do you think will happen if I remove this column from the producer and then start pushing messages without a venue name? What do you think will happen? Let's see some answers. The default value will come. No issue since it's non-mandatory. Perfect. All right, that's a good answer. That's a good answer. I'm good there, right? So since it is not a mandatory column, since it's not a required column, this change will not affect the consumers, right? So just so we know, you know, our program is still running, you know, our producer is still producing messages, our consumer is still consuming the messages, no problem, right? So this is what I'm going to do. So I am at the producer side, okay? So I'm going to remove this column right here. I'm going to remove this column right here, okay? So I'm going to remove venue name. And just because I removed it, I'm not going to populate it, right? Makes sense, right? We removed the value from the schema. I'm not going to populate the venue name anymore. The changes are automatically saved. Let me go back to producer. Actually, let me stop the producer first, okay? Since I'm going to rebuild producer, I'm going to stop it. So I'm going to stop the producer. Okay, consumer is still running, by the way. Since nothing is getting produced now, you know, it just seems like it's frozen, but the consumer program is actually running. As soon as the producer is pushing messages, it will start consuming, no problem, okay? So now I'm going to build the producer. Because I made two changes, right? One, I removed the venue name from the schema, right? And I'm also, since I removed the venue name, I don't want to set the venue name because, you know, I removed it. So I just commented out the line of code, okay? All right, so my producer is ready, right? Now I'm going to start my producer. Let's go back. Go producer and go start. Couple seconds to start. Let's wait. All right. Okay. Let's see. You see, I'm not populating a venue name anymore, right? So venue ID is the last field that I have because I removed venue name. Okay. Let's go back to consumer. You guys said consumer will be fine, right? Let's see. Yes, consumer is still fine, right? You see the venue name now. The venue name says not available. The consumer took the default value. The consumer took the because since the field is optional, in the absence of a value, the consumer took the default value. Great, right? See, schema changes are possible. Schema changes are possible. Now, let's try something more, okay? So now let's go back to our producer schema. All right, so I'm in the producer schema. Let's expand this. So venue name is not available, okay. So now Meetup decided, okay, for some reason Meetup decided I'm not going to provide the member ID anymore. This column right here. I'm going to remove this column from my feed. I'm going to remove this column from my message. I'm going to remove this from the schema. What do you think will happen? You need to be very precise on saying what error where. Wasn't that is correct? There will be an error, but error where? Primary value is required. Yes, require, it's a required value. You need to have it, but error where? Where would you see that error? While producing the message. Okay. Okay. Schema registry, producing, consumer deserialization error. Aniruddha is right. The error happens on the consumer side. Okay. And I'll tell you why, and I'll tell you why, you know, in, it depends actually. Error could have happened on producer side or consumer side, right? You could have given a better or a more accurate answer if I gave you another piece of information about the compatibility type, okay? Actually, the good answer is, without knowing the compatibility type, right, the error could happen on either sides, right? In our case, the error happens on the consumer side, and I'll explain you why, okay? So let's remove this member ID. Let's first stop our producer. So go back. Okay, so where I am right now, so producer, I'm going to stop it, okay? Producer RSVP, I'm going to remove the member ID. Right, so I'm going to remove the member ID. So since I removed the member ID, I also want to stop populating the member ID, right? So this is producer, so I'm stop populating it. Okay, now go back to producer, lifecycle, and install. So this is going to build the project, but now this time, we're not going to send any member ID, okay? We have not touched the consumer at all, okay? Consumer is still running. Let it run, fine, right? Okay. Okay, so it is successful. So producer application, let's start it. Okay, so producer is starting now. Let's give a couple more seconds for producer to start. Yeah, so producer is now pushing messages. You can see here, if I pause the output, you can see here, there is no member ID, right? So you got event name and member name, no member ID right here. Let's go to the consumer. Bam, there are errors, right? So let's pause the output here. Let's scroll up a little bit. Perfect. Missing required field member ID. The error is very clear because consumer cannot consume the messages anymore because consumer is expecting a column member underscore ID, which is a required column and it is not an optional column. That's why you see this error, right? All right. Now, why that's the case? I said, you know, you need to know another piece of information to give me a more accurate answer, right? Because the error could be on either side, producer or consumer side. What dictates where the error could happen is the compatibility type, okay? All right, so what is a compatibility type? First, let's see what's the compatibility type of our topic, okay? So let me copy this. Just the topic name, right? So check config. So this is the config of our schema registry, right? The compatibility type is set to backward, okay? And I'm going to explain what does backward compatibility type mean, okay? But let's see what's the compatibility type on our topic. So let's hit enter. So here it will say subject not found. Why it says subject not found is because we have not set a compatibility type for our topic, okay? We have not set it. In the absence of a compatibility type, Kafka Schema Registry will take the default compatibility type for the schema registry, which is backward, okay? So now we need to understand what is backward compatibility. What does it mean, you know? Now our topic is on backward compatibility mode because we have not specified one. So Kafka Schema Registry took the default compatibility type, which is backward for the topic, okay? All right. This is the definition of backward compatibility type in Kafka Schema Registry, okay? So The backward compatibility type dictates a consumer who can consume the new schema, okay, can also consume the current schema. Okay, so let's walk that through with an example. In our new schema, we removed the member ID, right? We removed the member ID. So a consumer is already consuming the schema without the member ID, will be able to consume the schema with member ID, okay? Because the new schema has an additional piece of information. You don't have member ID. When you get member ID, it's fine. You just ignore it. You don't care about it, right? So what we are saying here is a consumer who can consume the message with the new schema can also consume the message with the current schema. Okay, so that's what backward compatibility means. In this case, with backward compatibility, when you're making a change with backward compatibility, it is always advisable to change the consumers first, which is precisely what happened, right? Our change was allowed. We removed a member ID, which is a required column, and it is allowed as per the backward compatibility, right? Because backward compatibility says a consumer who can consume a message without member ID can consume a message with member ID. It is fine, right? But in our case, our consumers would actually break. Why? Because our consumer is expecting member ID, right? Backward compatibility says the new schema will be compatible to the previous schema, okay? So we need to change the consumers first when we are dealing with backward compatibility, okay? So let's look one more. Let's say I'm adding a new field called response. And this one doesn't have a default value. Here I'm adding a new field. Remember, here I'm adding a new field, okay? And it doesn't have a default value, which means it's a required column. What do you think about this change? Right? This change will not be accepted by Kafka Schema Registry because it is not backward compatible. Right? If you are consuming this, if a consumer is consuming message with this schema, with response, he won't be able to consume it with the current schema without response, right? Because he's consuming the messages with a required value. Now you took away the required value. You won't be able to do it. So this new schema is not backward compatible, right? So this change, if you're adding a new field, the producer side will break given the compatibility mode is backward. Makes sense, right? So that's why I said you need to know this piece of information that is the compatibility type to tell exactly where the break would be and based on the change you're doing, right? So with backward compatibility type, first you need to change the consumers. Deleting fields are okay. Okay, deleting fields are okay. Adding optional fields are okay, right? But you cannot add a required field. Your producer will break if you add a required field. And if you remove your required field, your consumer would break, okay? See, with this information, if you understand exactly what backward compatibility is, you can act better, right? You have the information, then you can act accordingly. Some might ask, if my consumer is breaking, why did Kafka Schema Registry allow the change in the first place? Kafka Schema Registry allowed the change in the first place because the backward compatibility rule allows it. Right? The backward compatibility rule allows removing or deleting required columns. It's not telling you everything is going to be work great, right? But it tells you if you are in backward compatibility mode, some changes you need to change the consumers first or else there will be consequence, right? So this is great. Backward compatibility is good if you have a good control on consumers, right? If you have a good control on consumer, as a producer, you can tell the consumer, hey, change first, okay? Because I'm going to make this change. I'm going to remove this column. You better make this change, right? Since my compatibility type is backward, this change is allowed. This change is allowed, but you need to make the change first or, you know, you will have a broken application when you come the next day, okay? So that's what backward compatibility is. But if you're a paying customer, you don't want disruption, right? Sometimes paying customers, they don't want to make any change, right? We have done several consulting gigs, right? And if we are pushing information to someone and if they're paying for that information, they really don't want to make a change, right? They'll be like, I'm not making a change. You make sure whatever, whenever you make a change, it's not disruptive to me. And if I have to make a change, I'll make the change on my own schedule. If you have such customers, then you need to think about forward compatibility type. Okay. Forward compatibility type tells you a customer who can consume the current schema will also be able to consume, can also consume the new schema. Right? Can also consume the new schema. So in the new schema, if you are removing another event ID column, right, that could be a problem, right? If you want to satisfy your consumers, if you don't want disruption to your consumers, you need to choose forward compatibility type. Make sense? So if I'm removing an event ID, right? So if I'm removing an event ID in forward compatibility mode, the schema registry itself won't let me make that change. Okay. So with forward compatibility mode, adding fields are okay. Deleting optional fields are okay. All right. Deleting optional fields are okay. Right. So, you know, if you don't want to bother your consumers, you need to change your your compatibility type on your topic to forward, right? When you do that, even you cannot even make the change. Your producer will break in the very first place, okay? So I'm going to show you how that happens, right? So how to change a topic to forward compatibility mode. So let's go here. So I have another Kafka Schema Registry, have another endpoint where I can set for the topic and I can say compatibility type equals forward. Okay, so let's do send. All right, so I got a 200 response, okay. So now if I go back and check the config, it won't say subject not found, it will say forward, okay. Let's check. There you go. See, it says forward now. So now when I'm trying to remove a required column, there will be a failure, okay? Instead of making a code change, I'm going to show you how I can use the REST endpoints and make a schema update, right? This is advisable. If you're trying to make a change to the schema, instead of making the change to your code, you can first try it here and make sure everything will be okay, right? So to change the schema, you would issue a post on the topic and on the version, and then you will give the body of the schema right here, okay? So here's the schema that I'm going to update. So this schema does not have an event ID. You see here, you got RSVP ID, group name, event ID, I've taken it away, right? So you got event name and the rest, okay? So let's take this. So remember, now we are trying to remove a required column in forward compatibility mode. And that is not allowed in forward compatibility mode, right? So this is protecting our consumers, right? Consumers in scenarios where consumers don't want to change, right? So let's go back. So let's put the schema here, right? So let's make sure event ID is not there. And we've already changed the compatibility type on this topic to forward. So let's issue a post. Okay. So now the status is very clear. The status code is 409 conflict, right? The schema being registered is incompatible with earlier schema. Okay. So you have essentially protected your consumers. So by accident, if you are trying to make a schema change like this, schema registry will protect you from making those changes. Making those changes which are not applicable for that compatibility type, right? So thereby you're protected, okay? All right, so we have seen backward and we have seen forward compatibility types so far. Okay, so now I want to tell you a couple more compatibility types. So backward and forward compatibility compares your new schema with your current schema, right? But if you want to make that comparison, with all registered schemas, you use backward transitive or forward transitive, okay? So backward transitive says, consumer who can consume the new schema can also consume all the registered schemas, okay? All the registered schemas. So it's backward compatible, not just to your current schema, but to all the registered schema, okay? Similarly, So you got forward. We saw the forward already, right? So forward transitive means consumer who can consume new schema can also consume all the registered schema, right? Not just the current schema, but all the registered schema, okay? So there are three more compatibility types, and that's where I wanted to wrap up. So you got full transitive, right? So full and full transitive are very restrictive, okay? There is very limited things you can do. You can only play around with optional fields. You know, you cannot touch the required columns at all. Again, full will just check the compatibility with the current schema, and full transitive will check against all registered schema. And none means no compatibility type whatsoever, right? We have never seen any production deployments with none compatibility type, okay? So those are all the compatibility types, right? Knowing this, you can make changes to your schema or you can evolve your schema very effectively, okay? You can evolve your schemas very effectively. You know when you make a change, who will be affected, right? In backward compatibility type, you know if you're removing a required column, you need to let your consumers know first and then remove it, right? If you want to protect your consumers from making any changes, you go with forward compatibility type, right? If you want to be too restrictive, you know, you can make it full, but that's going to make it harder on you for the schema to evolve, okay? So with this information, you can avoid making accidental changes, right? You have the power to know when you make this change, this is what is going to happen, okay? And you can act accordingly, all right? So that's our presentation. So let's summarize what we have seen so far, right? So for the beginners, we talked about what is Kafka, what is schema, and what is Avro, okay? Then we took a use case from meetup.com. Meetup.com now streams their RSVPs. Now what we did, we said meetup.com is now going to push RSVP messages to a Kafka cluster and we are going to consume it. So we wrote two programs, right? Producer and consumer programs. The producer pushed the RSVP messages to the Kafka cluster and the consumer consumed it with the schema, schema being the contract in the middle, right? And then we made some changes to the schema, right? First, we removed an optional column and see what kind of effect it had on the consumer. It had no effect, right? Consumer was happy. Then we removed a required column in backward compatibility type that broke our consumer, right? So then we talked about what backward compatibility type is. Then we talked about what forward compatibility type is. We updated our topic to forward compatibility type. Then we tried to remove a required column on that compatibility type. And Kafka Schema Registry did not allow us to change or remove a required column when we were in the forward compatibility type, right? So that's schema evolution with Kafka Schema Registry. All right. We're coming up very close to the 11 o'clock mark. Any questions do you have, guys, that we can answer? Any question related to Kafka or something, you know, more generic to big data? Anything about our courses, you know, feel free to ask. Paid courses are instructor-led. All our courses are online. You know, they are not instructor-led courses. You know, our courses are well-edited, pre-recorded, with nice production quality. So, you know, so you can take your course in your own pace. And we have a portal where you can ask your questions when you have questions and we'll respond promptly. Where we define the topic name when we retrieve the schema. Oh, here. So when we retrieve the schema, so where was it? Get latest schema, right? So you go here. So here's our topic name right here. HRW meetup.com webinar, you suffix with dash value and you issue versions and latest. So the topic name is this, hrwmeetup.com-webinar. And you can also see that in our code. Where is my application properties? Right here. hrwmeetup.com-webinar, right? Okay. Let's see, what other questions do we have? Yeah, that's exactly right. That's exactly right. Any questions, guys? There are other serialization formats as well, but Avro is by far the most efficient format. Interestingly, Avro is also created by Duck Cutting, who created Hadoop. So Avro is widely used, you know, pretty much a lot of, especially in Kafka, you know, most of the implementations that we have seen was used with Avro. Because it's versatile too, that's part of the reason as well. It's language agnostic, so you can, you know, you can use Python to serialize and use another programming language to deserialize it. All right, it's 11 o'clock. Is Kafka part of our Hadoop Hadoop developer course? Yes, Kafka is part of a Hadoop developer course. So we have a dedicated chapter on Kafka where we start with what is Kafka. We talk about topics, partitions, consumer groups, streaming messages from Meetup, the whole project that you saw now. Yeah, we talk about schema registry and all that. Is Kafka part of, okay, I answered that. Whom should we reach out? Any questions during a training for Spark? Again, you can email us, or you know, we have a Q&A section in our course portal, and where you can ask your questions, clarifications, whatnot, and we'll jump in and answer promptly. You can also send us an email to info@hadoopandrealworld.com, and we'll be happy to answer you on that as well. Do you have anything on KSQL or KStream? No, not at this time. We don't have any lessons on KSQL or KStreams, but in the future, of course, we constantly update our courses. So you can look at all our course update on hadoopandrealworld.com/upcoming releases. So if you go here, you say hadoopandrealworld.com upcoming releases, you will see all our course updates that we have made so far. So the last one that came was around, you know, in the first week of January. You know, that's when we updated the Hadoop developer course with Kafka Schema Registry. We also have another schema evolution in Avro that was updated in October. So we constantly update our courses. Any possibility of giving certification as well as paid courses in the future, just using an incremental resume? Yeah, we don't do certification at this time. We are looking into it. Yeah, I think in the future we will do provide certification too, I would think. Can we practice developing schema without? Could locate HBase video in YouTube? I think you're asking about like HBase tutorials, right? I mean, we have a couple of lessons on HBase and Hadoop developer course. I don't think we have put anything on YouTube for HBase. But HBase documentation is also good. You know, you can read the documentation too. Yes, multiple consumers can subscribe to a topic, yes. And, you know, but once consumer, you can also have multiple consumers in a consumer group consuming the same topic. So you can distribute your load on the consumer side as well. Okay, cool. All right, we will definitely share the recording. Yeah. All right, cool. So this was fun, guys. It's 11:03. I don't want to take up any more of your time. Thank you so much for joining. Again, we will share the recording on YouTube. And if you have any questions in the meantime, feel free to send us an email to info@hadoopandrealworld.com. Okay. Again, it's always a pleasure to do these webinars. I always have a blast. You guys have a great rest of your weekend. Okay. All right. Thank you, guys. Bye.